Though anchoring is a frequent operation on board, but it's critical one like many other operation on board and required a professional approach. However, it can be carried out safely with proper planning, with a properly instructed bridge team, and when positive onboard management and leadership are shown. Not knowing the correct procedure of anchoring or an improper anchoring could cause damage and loss to the vessel, other vessels, property, and the environment. The consequential losses of grounding and collision due to anchor dragging or loss can be significant.
Guys, in this video story which you will be going to see, I will try to demonstrate how we do anchoring safely at deep water.
The propeller and the engine helps the vessel to sail in the seas. However, there are various occasions when vessel needs to be idle or wait in the harbor, or in case of engine failure, then to maintain sustainability of ship in water, an anchor gets used. In such events, anchor will be used to hold the ship, or else ship will drift away due to wind and current. If you are not a seafarer or been on the ship, the first impression when it comes of anchor is that of traditional anchor. Nowadays, ships use stockless anchor. The stockless anchor is mainly because design is flat and can be stored easily. It comprises of following: the shank, which is the stem of the anchor. When pulled, it will bury the anchor in the direction of pull. The crown connects the various parts of the anchor. The crown unit is pivoted to the shank so that it can swing to 45 degrees to either side of the shank. The flukes are long and heavy and have projecting shoulders at their base that catch on the seabed. As more drag is exerted, the shoulders force the fluke downward into the bottom. The windlass brake system is essential to secure and control lowering of the chain. The brake needs to be maintained and adjusted as per maker instructions. The windlass drives the gypsy head and the anchor chain resting on it. The hawse pipe is the passage in the ship's deck which carries the chain to the anchor and also acts as anchor securing point. The hawse pipe also consists of water spray holes which washes the mud and dirt on the anchor and the chain as it is heaved up. Chain stopper is fitted to secure the anchor chain when riding the anchor, thereby relieving the strain on the windlass. It is used for securing the anchor in the housed position in the hawse pipe. The riding powell is a small rotating drum forward of gypsy wheel which is used to carry chain in the hawse pipe. The anchor chain travels through the spurling pipe to the gypsy drum from the chain locker. The chain locker is the room below the mooring deck which is used for storing the anchor. Generally, windlass are electrically or hydraulically driven, and in our case it is hydraulically driven. How well the anchor will hold also depends upon how long and how well the cable is laid. Generally, length of the cable outside the hawse pipe is 5 times the depth of water, depending on the depth of water in which vessel anchors. However, on larger vessel, it is prudent to increase this mark between 6 to 10 times the depth, depending on the depth of water and under keel clearance. Scope of the cable is defined as the ratio between length of cable and depth of the water. The scope of the cable paid out of the hose pipe affects the angle at which cable pulls on the anchor, and that determines the holding power of anchor. A 5-degree angle between the seabed and the cable where it connects to the anchor results in loss of 25% of its pull on the anchor. This loss increases over 50% at an angle of 15 degree. Hence, laying of cable properly along the seabed is essential. If the number of shackles on the anchor permits, a scope of 6 recommended. Other factors to be considered in determining the scope and length of cable laid out are the weather conditions, holding ground, wind, current, tidal streams, and the traffic congestion at the anchorage. Sufficient scope assists in absorbing short loads, which assist in holding the vessel and reduces the impact on windlass, thereby protecting it. The operation of windlass needs to be understood clearly. Windlass heaving the anchor is designed for vertical lift at least 5 length of cable along with anchor. However, age of machinery and its past performance must be taken into consideration when deciding to anchor. Weather forecast should be noted and weather should be closely monitored during anchoring, and criteria when anchoring should be avoided should be clearly defined by master. Lack of awareness has proven to be one of the major reasons for anchor losses. The nature of seabed has significant effect on anchor's holding power. The best holding power is provided by the clay, but it can have sucking effect and needs to be considered for prolonged anchorage. Also, sand provide good holding power. Pebbles and soft mud have low holding power, and anchor at such grounds may drag slowly. Anchoring is not recommended on shell or rocky bottom or on slopes where it can be wedged in large cracks or get lodged in large fusions. Pilot books, sailing directions, and guide to port entry provide detailed information on anchorage, seabed, and prevailing weather conditions. Let us look into various anchoring methods before proceeding further with our anchoring operation. One of the methods is by windlass power, also known as walkback. In walkback method, cable is paid out by windlass at a fixed speed. Upon reaching the anchoring position, the speed over the ground is gradually brought to zero and the anchor is lowered in water. This method is usually of longer duration than let go method. Walkback method is only generally used and recommended on large ships above 100,000 gross tonnage. Let go method is used in wide range of vessels from small crafts and pleasure yachts to large ships with tonnage varying up to 100,000 gross tonnage. In let go method, the cable is let slip under its own weight from the hose pipe by gravity. The weight on the cable, windlass brake holding power, and the momentum of the vessel are factors to be controlled by the ship crew to ensure that cable digs in and the cable is subsequently let to extend backwards. Let go anchor is generally used in shallow water, relatively at the depth of 20 to 25 meters, with soft seabed. Lowering by windlass and let go control by brake means that anchor is lowered by windlass until 10 to 15 meters from the bottom and then let go while being controlled to limit the dynamic loads from the weight of anchor and chain. This method is suitable for depth range of 20 to 50 meters and for hard and rocky seabed when any significant impact may damage the anchor. Lowering by windlass to bottom is used to anchor at depth more than 50 meters. For any of the method, ensure to open the lashing and remove the chain stopper from anchor chain. A locking arrangement is also provided for chain stopper to avoid the gluten bar from falling into place, which can damage the windlass when anchoring is in operation.
The nearest target is around 5 cables. We have to be very careful. We'll be anchoring around with the 11 cycles on there.
Before lowering the anchor, the anchor team must be called to bridge for anchoring meeting. The standard instruction to the anchoring team must include manning, communication, and the orders used during anchor operation. Any deviation to standard procedure must be communicated upfront. Apart from speed, the direction from which to approach the anchoring position is important. The best approach heading is of heading into the wind and tide. The heading of similar sized anchored vessels can give a quite accurate sense of approach heading. Once the vessel is around half a mile from the anchoring position, we can give stern moment. This is to ensure that vessel is completely stopped at the anchoring position and there is no headway in the forward direction. During a stern movement, the vessel would turn to starboard side for right hand fixed pitch propellers. The vessel must be reduced to nearly zero or very slow motion stern when anchoring.
Get to starboard side and head into against the current. Okay, you can see how nicely it is setting
up. Lowering by windlass is recommended in the depth more than 50 meter, and in our case the depth is around 82 meters. So we will be lowering the anchor by gear all the way to the bottom. Extreme precautions are to be observed while dropping anchor in deep water.
Negative speed, right? 0.2. So very easy, your cable will lay down. Okay, we have started now.
Ensure that entire cable is walked out under power. While lowering the anchor, the vessel should be fully stopped with no speed over the ground. After laying 1 to 2 shackles on the seabed, use short burst of engine power, no more than dead slow ahead or astern, to wrench the cable to the required length. Proper communication is very important during anchoring operation to avoid any miscommunication. After the vessel is brought up, place the chain stopper bar into the locked position, tighten the windlass brake and disengage the gear. Check the position regularly by manual as well as electronic means to confirm that ship is within swinging circle at all times and not dragging. Heaving anchor in rough weather is extremely challenging and thus weather should be monitored at all times. Mistakes often result in grounding or collisions. The key is to monitor environmental conditions and leave the anchorage in time before adverse conditions put the operations at risk. This is vitally important as almost half of the reported anchor losses are due to excessive environmental loads. If you have any questions or suggestions, please drop your comments below and I will respond to that at earliest. If you like this video, please do share and subscribe the channel and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified for more ship related videos.